cell phones, they surround us. You drive some 50 kilometers off Chennai, off Delhi, off Mumbai, and you realize the reality really changes. People perhaps aren't checking their cell phones as often as you and I do. You drive another 100 kilometers, and you realize that most women and children perhaps don't have access to the online world. There's perhaps one simple Java phone, and the male lead at the household level pockets it with pride. Digitization has changed us. We now live in a society where we use YouTube videos to learn about yoga and Ayurveda. We now use payment apps to pay our milkman and our household help. We use WhatsApp to share family gossip and pictures and whatnot. But how digitized is the developing world? Over a fifth of the world's poor live in India. About 75% of us live in India's villages. And let me give you a very interesting number. Only 55% of the entire humanity accesses the World Wide Web. Extrapolate this to the developing world. Think about how many people in India really access the internet. And if you start doing that, it'll bring to light the millions of unconnected people who live across villages and numerous small towns in India, who are not part of our online debates, of our Facebook discussions and our fights over news channels and our Instagrams and our Snapchats and those other millions of apps that we so dearly and use all the time. Think about all those people. Think about all those people who perhaps have little intermittent or no access to the trials, fears, and madness of the online world. Ladies and gentlemen, I am Prerna Mukharya, and I'm here to talk to you about small data, the magic of small numbers, of surveys, of households, of individuals you reach out to, and there's only one way and one way alone of reaching out to them. It's by going to them, by going up to their household door and knocking. And these are individuals who will welcome you in. I do a lot of field work, and I go on field missions, and my work takes me to the rural and remote parts of India. I've covered about 7,000 villages in India till now. And I'm somebody who likes her tea and coffee very, very strong. Yeah, give me another round of applause on this, please. I'm bootstrapped and we make money, and I want to tell everybody that, you know, for-profit social enterprises can exist, you know. Anyway, all right. So I like my tea and coffee very strong, and no milk and very little sugar. And on one of these rural missions, I go up to this one household, and this little woman comes out with a tray in her hand, tiny teacups, and the tea is as milky as a bedsheet, and it's so sugary. And I can't drink it. I can't drink it. And this happens once or twice. And then I go back to my little hotel, and I start thinking. Think about the three variables: the tiny teacups, the milk, and the sugar. They are tiny because these households have limited resources. Milk is hard to come by, and sugar is very expensive. When I walk into these households assume that I will change their lives for the better. They think I'm that change maker. Ladies and gentlemen, I am that data collector. When I go into these households, I take a train, I'll take a shared auto, I'll travel for 2 days, and I'll go up to them. My job could be on any particular day to walk into a public school where a local midday meal worker is on strike because not enough eggs are being sent to her school. On another day, I might be interviewing a local healthcare ASHA worker who doesn't have enough resources at the village level. I could be interviewing a 15-year-old girl who has 2 kids. She's just 15. Or I could be talking to a 7th-grade student who's supposed to be a full-time student, but he works all the time on a farm. My job is to communicate their wants, their wishes, and their needs to policymakers who sit at the district level, who sit at the state level, and who sit at the center, so that they can understand what they are doing right, what they are doing wrong, so they can start the right policies and close the wrong ones. I am that data collector. I am that neutral person who doesn't get to show emotion when I walk into your households, when you show your deepest, darkest secrets with me, when you share your fears with me. I am that neutral person who doesn't get to get angry as you say the most unjust of things to me. I must stay neutral, and I must pen down things exactly as you say them to me. I don't have the luxury to be one with you. And for that reason, they also call me an investigator. And that's the power of small data, of bringing the voices of thousands of these people all on the same plane. So whether it's cold outside, whether it's raining, whether it's snowing, whether there's a storm or whether there's a school drowning, I'm on the job. I am that data collector. And I have often wondered if everybody can afford me and other data collectors like me. And sadly, my answer has been no. And I started thinking about the tiny teacup again. I started thinking, can I build a technology solution that can bring this superset of humanity onto the same platform? And mind my words, I say superset of humanity, right? I'm talking about those people who don't make it to our discussions. And I started thinking of two questions. And there was a chain of events. A lot of these people in the villages and at the community level interact very closely with not-for-profits. And then these not-for-profits report to the big funders, to the donors, and the government. And I started wondering, can I bring all these guys onto the same platform? Can I get them to talk? Can I get them to exchange data sets? Can I bring the big funders sitting in the New Yorks and the DCs and the Zimbabwes of the world to connect with not-for-profits, irrespective of their location on the basis of small data sets? At the other end, could I get the very, very small NGO, the volunteer-driven, the 4 or 5 people not-for-profit, build their own numbers, measure their own impact for no money at all, and connect with funders irrespective of their location? And my answer was yes. I can help these organizations track their own metrics. And so I've built this technology which does just that. And how has this changed things? It's helping organizations compete for that same amount of funding. It's brought in competition in the development sector, a word that is perhaps considered dirty in the development sector. These organizations are now competing for that same amount of money. So the good guys do well and the bad guys fall out. I remember this quick story from 2015. I went to this tiny village in Uttar Pradesh. It was called Gulni. And I was there to do an education-based survey. And it took me 2 days to get there. I had to take local trains and shared autos and whatnot. And one of the pictures you saw is of me in that local train. And in that bogey of some 12 seats, there were 21 of us, right? And I was sitting on top of my suitcase and huddled up. And when I reached the school, there's just a structure. There's no cement. There's nothing on the walls. There is no school as such. There are no teachers and there are no students. And there's a board outside and it's painted and it says, in Hindi, and I'll translate this, 12 baje ke pehle aana nahi aur 2 baje ke pehle 2 baje tak rukna nahi, which translates to, we don't come in before 12 and we don't stay after 2. And then I go into the village and everybody is so excited to see me because these villages don't get a lot of outsiders. And some 200 people surround me, and I don't know what to do with my survey because there is no education. And then this man walks up to me, and I remember him. I remember his bloodshot eyes. And he had 5 kids, and he tells me, there is no school. I can't send them to the public school. I can't send them for private tuitions. I'm a poor farmer. People like you come to me, and they tell me that, you know, you can change my life. Why don't you come back when you really can change my life? I feel like it's been 4 years since, and I think I'm finally ready to go back to that village and tell him that, you know, maybe I can make a difference. Ladies and gentlemen, always remember, it's these moments that make us, that break us, and that shape us, right? Sometimes it really helps to think small. Maybe all of us can't change the entire world, but maybe we can make our own small little difference. I'll leave you with one last thought. In the morning, when you pull out your newspaper and you find some numbers, or you're looking at your cell phone and you see some data in it, think about the quantum of effort somebody put in. Think about the number of kilometers somebody walked. Think about the data collector and all data collectors who worked so hard so you could look at that article while sipping on your tea. Think about small data. Thank you.